In fact, Benny Goodman showed very little imagination about the possible feelings of his players, white or black. He would take on a musician because he liked his style. But that, for Benny, was the end of the story. The black saxophonist Wardell Gray suffered particularly. Benny made it clear that he admired his playing. But when, on a residency in Las Vegas, Gray was not allowed to live at the same hotel as his white band colleagues, but had to stay at a black place out at the edge of the desert, Goodman made no allowances at all. The incident that followed alienated Milt Bernhardt and could have broken up the whole band.
Wardell had been drinking. He'd become so depressed, so demoralized, that he'd had some booze that night. And I remember saying to him, "Take it easy, Wardell." And he was mumbling about Benny letting him down. And so we got on the stand, and Wardell just about made it. And we began to play, and Wardell had a chorus on "Don't Be That Way." And he didn't get up in a hurry. Benny stopped the band. Now it's dead silence. Full house on a Saturday night. And he looked at Wardell, and then he said, "Get off the stand, Pops." And it was loud. And Wardell was in shock. He was drunk, but he was in shock, too. Couldn't move right away. And now Benny really screamed it. "Did you hear me? Get off the stand! Get off!" And he began to wave his clarinet around. And we're all, you know, petrified. And Wardell stood up very slowly and kind of hang-dogged off the stand, almost shuffling. And he said, "Take your instruments." So Wardell shuffled back slowly and got his saxophone and clarinet, started back off the stage, at which point Benny stopped him and said, "Wait a minute." And Wardell turned around, terror on his face. Benny grabbed the clarinet that Wardell had and said, "Give me my clarinet." He had given it to him as a present a few months earlier. "Give me that clarinet." Now, there couldn't have been a man in the band that hadn't developed on the spot a feeling about Benny Goodman that bordered on homicide. And me, I was one of the strongest. We got through that show. We went ahead with the show. The audience was stunned. And you have no explanation. It's an empty chair. It ended, and we all went off stage. And I found Wardell, who had already been told by the manager already that he wasn't fired. As a matter of fact, Wardell had a contract. He was the only guy in the band that Benny had signed to a year. We were about 6 months into that year. But not only wasn't it just to be difficult, Benny decided to demote Wardell to fourth tenor so there'd be no solos and no featured stuff, but he couldn't leave the band. Have to stay. And that night I gave my notice, found the manager, and I said, "How soon can I leave?" "2 weeks, you gotta give 2 weeks." So I said, "Then 2 weeks from tonight and I'm done." And as soon as I gave my notice, I was demoted to third trombone.
Track with Wardell Gray on tenor sax in Happier Times. Benny's choice of music on the bandstand was also strangely erratic. Sax and clarinet player Walt Levinsky remembers his almost stubborn unawareness of what the public wanted.
Benny was so strange. We were playing out in Wisconsin, and the The ballroom was so packed, he couldn't move in there. It was just absolutely packed. And we're playing on, you know, all the Benny standards, you know. And at one point, right before the intermission, Benny's looking through his book and he says, Derivations. Now, Derivations is a song that Morton Gould had written for Benny. I mean, it wasn't a song, it was like a 4 or 5, you know, movement piece or something. So he starts playing Derivations, and it's making everybody infuriated. They're really angry now, you know. I mean, they came expecting to hear Big John Special or something. they were looking for Morton Gould's Derivation. Halfway through it, people, and there had to have been thousands of people in that ballroom. It was a big ballroom. By the time the sound got to the back of the room and they heard what was going on, the whole place was, I thought they were going to kill Benny. I really thought they were going to attack him. And he's just turning pages. He just keeps right on going, you know. Until finally, he goes to turn the page. Next thing, his music is like all the way out on the floor, and it was sliding down the stage now and onto the dance floor. And we're all dying, you know, we're sitting there watching this, and finally he ran out of music. There was no more music, you know, and people are booing and are yelling, and I thought there was going to be a riot. And Benny's like oblivious, you know, he doesn't know about all that. I said, Benny, I says, now's the time to play 1 o'clock jump. And we did, we played it. And within about half a minute, like, the crowd came back.
Thank you.
1 o'clock jump, the number that saved the day. A Goodman borrowing from the Count Basie repertoire. In spite of his oddnesses, Benny maintained a very high-class band, which in its prime included future leaders in their own right, like drummer Gene Krupa and trumpeter Harry James, perhaps a more raucous character than he seemed, according to Jerry Jerome.
Harry would go out and get porno film, and we'd be up in the musicians' room roaring with laughter because they were so corny. They were not sexy. They were sexy, but they were so corny, the scripts. The situations, you know, oh my God, it was, I can't even give you the titles of some of these things, which I remember. But, you know, you sit there and you just, it puts you in a good mood, it would just be funny, you know, how they can do that.
Musicians don't change much, do they? Star soloists like Harry James, if they weren't contemplating forming their own bands, were often on the receiving end of tempting offers from other bands. Leaders were not particularly scrupulous about stealing the men they needed, as one of the last surviving swing band leaders, Jay McShann, now admits.
You know, back in those days, you know, cats used to raid each other for the band, you know. You got five or six good men, top men. Well, you know, they're gonna always be after those men. And so I knew Nat had the guys because he had one of the greatest brass sections during that time in the country. That's in the country. You know, he actually did. He had a hell of a brass section, had a hell of a reed section. So I went up there and, you know, first I knew I had to try to make some kind of impression, and this fella here in town had a lot of money, and so I borrowed money from him to go up there to bring these guys back. And it was on a Monday night, you know, like they have the Blue Monday party, and all the cats were sitting in and blowing. And every time I seen a cat and heard a cat that I liked, I'd have to wait just to bring him over there, you know, send him a drink, send the band a drink, just kept the drinks jumping and just kept things going. So they said, well, who is this cat over here from Kansas City? Man, this cat's spending money like it's going out of style. What I did, I parted so hard, I ran out of money.
Jay McShann duly got away with the men he needed for his lineup. Although, as ever, what goes around comes around. Several years later, McShann found that Earl Father Hines, a more prosperous leader than himself, was doing the same thing to him.
He says, you got about five guys I want out of your band. He says, and I'm going to tell you, I'm going to get them. He said, because I got the money to get them, you know. So I said, well, when he made a statement like that, I knew. I says, well, wait, I don't want to make him mad. So he says, especially I want Charlie Parker. I says, well, I says, okay. He said, do you owe any money? I said, yeah, he owes me some money. I said, all of them owe me money. He says, well, you just find out how much they owe you, and I'll give you the money and get you straight. He said, you won't lose no money on your deal. I said, okay. I'll tell you something. He says, you're a little young in the business, Earl told me. He says, I'm going to take Charlie Parker and I'll make him show you how to make a man out of him. He said, because he said, you're a little bit young. He says, you haven't had too much experience with these guys. He said, I'll show you how to make a man out of him. So then about 2 or 3 months later, I saw Earl Hines in New York in the band. Earl looked up. He says, come here. He said, Come get this Charlie Parker and get him out of my sight. He says, he owes everybody in town, every loan shark in town, he owes everybody in the band. Brought him a brand new horn. He don't know what happened to the horn. He don't know where the horn is. He, get him out of here. I said, well, you told me you was going to make a man out of him. He said, forget it.